been able to actually set up everything, have a working application. Okay. And now we are going to see how the actual application works, and we are going to see how the authentication and so on work, and a few other features which are available only in full stack mode. Actually, you can enable them in minimal mode, but it's more effort than just going full stack. Now, if you pointed your browser to the localhost 88 port, you probably have seen everything you have already set up for you. And you probably have seen that there is a login button in the upper right corner. Okay, it's already running. And you see here that I have a login button because Tubergears already set up for me authentication users and so on. I can, of course, change models and everything in the authentication stack, but usually it's fine just using the default one, which is provided for free. The default username and password for the user which is created by the default setup app script is manager and manage path. Now, what I'm going to show you is that if I try to actually log in, it's just going to crash. Okay. And what's the reason? Well, here you are seeing the interactive debugger of Tubergears, and you can see that it's actually telling me that there is no table for the users because I never created the database. How do I create the database? Well, creating the database is actually one of the things that the setup script is in charge of. You can see the setup script inside the web setup directory. You see that you have the controllers, templates, models, and so on, and you have a web setup directory. Inside this directory, you have the schema script, which is in charge of creating tables and so on. By default, this script is not important. It's just nearly empty because it just tells to SQL Alchemy to create every table. If you look at it, it's just one line, create all. Okay? The important part is the bootstrap script, which is the one which is actually in charge of creating users, group, and permissions, and so on. So this is the script that is actually creating our database. And how you can run it? You can run it through the Gearbox setup app command. This is a command that, like the serve command, is going to serve your application. The setup app command is going to set up your application. So it's going to like enable any pluggable application, any extension, and set up the database of all of them and so on. You never run the web setup script manually. You just run the setup app script, and then he runs the setup script, the web setup script. One of the things that the setup app script is also in charge of, the setup app command is in charge of, is initializing, you see, tables and migration support. So I have migrations for free in Tubergears in every database that is gets created. And by default, it works by creating a SQLite database, which is named devdata.db. You can, of course, change this, and this is declared inside the configuration file, which is development.ini. If you open development.ini, you will see that there is a path for the database, a lot of options, and here you see that it tells to SQL Alchemy to use devdata.db. So here you can point it to PostgreSQL or whatever you want to use. Now that my database is in place, I can actually try to log in again. And now it succeeds and tells me, welcome back, manager. Manager, manage pass, default credentials. And now you see that Tubergears welcomes me because I have been able to log in, and I have an additional logout button. And it appeared an admin link, which is currently not going to work because we disabled it by the skip Tosca widget options. We are going to see the admin later on when switching to Python 2. Everyone have been able to create a database, so on. Any question? Now, if you have your database in place and you are able to log in with the users table, we are going to see how authorization works in TurboGears, okay? There is a secure controller, which is automatically created for us by the quick start and mounted at the sec URL, okay? If I try to go here and I log it in, I get secure controller here. It's exactly the same as the index page. It exposes the same template, there are no difference, but it tells me that I'm inside the secure controller. And if I log out and I try to go again to the secure controller, it tells me that it's only for people with managed permission. So it blocks me, it makes me log in, and then sends me to the secure controller. So you see that you have a controller which is available only for users that have a specific kind of permission. And how this is handled? It's handled through the models of your users. TurboGears by default create the concept of user, group, and permission. Okay, and I can see how these models are declared inside the modelsout.py inside my project. There is the model directory, which inside has the out.py file, which the Gearbox quick start command created for me. And that file declared the concept of all my authorization related entities. Like I have groups, which have actually a group name, a display name, time of creation, list of users inside the group. I have the concept of the user, which has a username, email address, display name, and so on. And I have a concept of permissions, which are, in fact, what we are checking for. Okay, so our current secure controller checks for the managed permission for our user. So how this check is performed, it's easy to see at the any of the function that is provided inside the quick start and which is exposed with a permission requirement. And this is the core part, is this command. This decorator require predicates as permission, which permission, and the message to show in case the permission is not met. Okay. How this works? Well, the require decorator tells to TurboGears that the URL, the method I'm exposing, has some kind of requirement. And in specifically, every single requirement is a predicate. So it evaluates to true or false, and nothing more. So it can be any function that evaluates to true or false. And TurboGears provides a bunch of predicates by default available inside the tg.predicate module. And has permission in one of those predicates, which looks at the currently authenticated user, checks for the permission you specified, in this case manage, and if it doesn't have that permission, it fails. So the requirement is not met, my message is shown, and TurboGears by default, when a requirement is not met, it sends you to the login page. So the user can log in and go back to the get sent back to the page. you can have a, well, it's actually not well formed. It was inside the slide. When I exported it to PDF, it probably broke. And at this page, which is authorization.html, it's the same link you saw before, like with turbogears /authorization.html added. You have a list of all the available predicates. And it explains you how TurboGears authentication works, and which predicates are available are listed here, built-in predicate checkers. So we have like the user has not to be anonymous, so any user is fine. Is this specific user like manager, or is inside this group, is inside all of this group, is in any of this group, has this permission, has all these permissions. And you can also negate an existing predicate so that it gets the opposite of what it will do. And you can also have compound predicates, like it has to meet all these predicates or it has to meet any of these predicates. So you can implement pretty complex requirements and authorization for any URL. Now if I go to my controller of the Quick Started application, to my root controller, you can see that there is already defined a bunch of URLs with some requirements. Like the manage permission only URL is available only for users with manage. The editor user only URL is available only for the editor user. There are a bunch of simple examples. And so, for example, if I try to go to editor only, how it's called, editor user only, it will tell me that I'm not the editor, because in fact I'm the manager. While if I try to go to the manage permission only, it will work as expected because I'm the manager. They are just the index, it's not different in any way the page, it's just to show you how permission authentication requirements work. Authorization, sorry, more than authentication. And here, how is going to work on our database? So how is going to be our database and how we are going to use it? Well, I hope your database doesn't actually look like this, because in that case you are in a real mess. But if your database is pretty sane somehow, you can declare it with TurboGears using SQL Alchemy for SQL database and Ming for MongoDB database. So TurboGears supports out of the box both MongoDB and any SQL database supported by SQL Alchemy. Both are first citizens, means both are really hardcore parts of the framework. So you can use the TurboGears admin also MongoDB, which is one of the most cool features of TurboGears, because usually, like many other frameworks that have something like an admin, it works only like on SQL Alchemy or only on their main ORM. And both are supported out of the box. You don't need to install anything to have support for them. And to create a project that uses MongoDB, you just have to pass the --ming option and nothing more. You get the project with the same exact features, the same users, the same permissions and everything you had when working with SQLite databases. You just have on MongoDB. And if you don't want a database at all, or you want to set up your own database, like using, I don't know, Cassandra or any other database you might want to use, you just can use the --NoSA options to disable all the database. Actually, the option name is not really meaningful, because it stands for NoSQL Alchemy, because it was the only database available at the time that option was in place. So. And if you want to see all the available options for the quick start, if you run Gearbox Help Quick Start, it will show you all the possible options you have when creating a TurboGears application. And there are actually pretty a lot of them. Like you can disable authentication, you can use Mako in place of Genshi, you can use Jinja in place of Genshi, you can use Kejiki in place of Genshi. You can enable geographic utility support to BIOS as a built-in DGX GIS option extension, which permits some work on maps and so on. You can change your ORM and switch between MongoDB and SQL Alchemy. You can disable migrations if you don't want them. You can use the older version of Tosca widgets, which you don't want to do, but it's just there for backward compatibility. You can disable Tosca widgets at all, and you can disable Genshi. This specific option is a part because even if you start with Jinja, you will still have support for Genshi due to make possible to use pluggable application and third-party extensions. If you want to totally disable Genshi support, you have to tell it explicitly. Now, I don't know if any of you ever used SQL Alchemy before. It's pretty simple, actually. It's more like how real databases work. And by default, TurboGears set it in a way which is kind called declarative, with a unit of work that you need to flush and so on. But it's pretty simple at the end. To create a new model, you just perform the DB session head of what you just created. In this case, I suppose I have a page model. And to read it, you just perform a query on what you want to get and provide some kind of filters. Like in this case, I want the page which is named index. And you can tell to SQL Alchemy if you want one, the first, or all of them. And it will just generate this SQL statement for you. If you want to update something, you just update the property of the object. And if you want to delete an object, a row from your tables, you just perform DB session delete. Now to start playing with SQL Alchemy, we are going to follow the TurboGears Wiki in 20 minutes tutorial, which is the default, most common TurboGears tutorial that tells you how to create a simple wiki application like Wikipedia, more simpler, actually. And we can go directly to the wiki model section and skip all the previous one because you already know how to create a TurboGears application, install TurboGears, and so on. Voila. Okay, the first thing I'm going to do is actually create a page file where I'm going to put my page model. Okay, so I'm just going to continue from the application I already have. And this page file is going to contain the page model declaration, which is actually this one. Tells to SQL Alchemy which table to use. I'm going to save my pages inside the page table. It tells SQL Alchemy to create an ID field, which is a primary key and is going to be automatically incremented for me by SQL Alchemy. It tells to SQL Alchemy to create a page name field, which is going to contain the title, the name of the page, which we are going to use as the URL to open that page, which is of type text and has a unique constraint, so we don't have two pages which have the same URL. And we are going just to put some data inside the page, which currently is just text. We are not going to have complex things, even though the wiki in 20 minutes tutorial actually makes you have wiki words, a full featured wiki and so on. We are going to have a stripped down version of the tutorial. So for simplicity, I'm just going to copy from the tutorial the code, so I don't have to rewrite it from scratch. I'm going to put it inside my project, inside the models, in a file named page.py. Voila. Well, remember to rename the model from where the core parts of the database support are imported, because it is actually from your project. So in my case, it's from my project. By the example, it's called Wiki20. And now to make TurboGears aware that I'm going to use my model explicitly, I'm going to import it inside the init of the models. So voila. So you see that on the documentation makes you both create the model inside the page.py file and makes you import it inside the model init file. Everything you have inside the init is considered by TurboGears a privileged model. So it's like available in the admin and so on. If you forget to put it inside the init, it still is used, it still is created the table and so on, but it's like a private model that people that contribute to your application or so on should not care about. Like, it's often used for many-to-many relationship support tables, because you don't access them directly. They are just used internally by your other models and so on. So always put it inside the init of the model if it is an actual entity, like in this case, the page, because I'm actually going to work with pages. Now that I declared my page, what I need to do is actually add the table for the page to my database. If I look at my dev data and I ask him for the schema, you see that there are a lot of tables, but there is no table for your page, okay? Usually on more complex projects, you will do a migration to add the table and so on. But in our case, as it is pretty simple, we are just going to run again the gearbox setup app command, which is going to run again the schema initialization and the setup, the bootstrap of the models. The schema initialization part is just going to see that most of the tables are already there and skip them, and is going to create the new tables, while the bootstrap part is just going to fail because the models are already there. So we are going to get an error, but we are going to have what we want. Okay, you see that it ran and it created the tables correctly, but it then failed when bootstrapping the data, because I already have my managers group and so on. But I don't care, because I already have them and they already work. So now if I again ask for the schema, I can see that the page is now there in place and I can start using it. Now, let's go on with the, yes. Check that you are importing it for the correct module, because if you copied the code from the example, it imports it from wiki20.model, while it should be called yourproject.model. Okay, now going forward, I'm going to add to my Bootstrap script a page so I can start playing with it already on my database. So I don't start empty, I already have some kind of page which I can start reading and so on. So I'm going to edit the web setup and edit the Bootstrap file. And the first thing I'm going to do is like adding my page wherever you want. It actually doesn't matter. I'm just going to add it at the beginning before everything else. While I'm just going to call it index instead of front page, just because it makes more sense to me. Okay, now that I'm telling to my Bootstrap script to create a default page, I can run again the setup app, and now instead I remove the previous database so it gets created everything from scratch and so on. And also my page is added. Okay, so no more errors now because it create performed everything. And if I try to look at the pages I have, you will see that there is the page that got created by the Bootstrap script. Now, if you have your page correctly in place, we can start playing with it. So we can start adding a controller to load the page and so on. The first part I'm going to do is actually add a page template, which is available here in the adding view sections. You have the template code. This one. And I'm just going to copy it. And I'm going to save it inside a template called page.html. And now that my template is in place, I of course need to add a controller which exposes the template. So I'm going to edit my root controller, and wherever you want, actually I'm going just to put it after the index. I'm going to expose my template. The template I copied expects the page to be called wiki page, so I'm just going to return a dictionary with wiki page, and for now none, because I don't have any wiki page. Now, because I changed my controller, I needed to restart the server, okay? And this is something you can avoid. The Gearbox serve has an option, which is --reload, that whenever the code changes, it automatically restarts the server. So we don't have to restart it by hand each time we change something. So now I'm restarting it with the --reload option, so it automatically restarts things when something changes. Now the issue is that if I go to the pages page and try to open my index, it is of course going to fail because I'm going to pass to the template none, and the template tries to show the page name, the page data and so on, which are not available for none. Okay. So the next thing I need to do is actually get the page from the database so I can send to the template an actual page it can render. And the, to get the page, I'm just going to do to get it from my DB session and query it. And I'm going to query for model.page, which is my page model. I'm going to get every page that matches the page name that I got by argument. And now I want just the only one page. There shouldn't be more than one page that matches that name. So I ask SQL Alchemy to give me one page, and I pass it forward to my template. Okay, so I set up the query to fetch it from the database, and I just pass it to the template. And now if I reload my page, I actually get the index page, which inside has initial data. And it automatically reloaded the server because I used the reload option. You can see it here that it logs restarting because your root file has changed. So I didn't have to restart it again like before. By default, TurboGears logs every single SQL statement your application is going to perform, which provides a lot of noise. If that bothers you, you can disable it inside the configuration file. I'm just going to disable it because it provides a lot of noise I don't need now. And you can edit the development.ini file, which is the configuration file for your project. And at the end of the file, you have the configuration for logging. I can go to the SQL Alchemy section and switch it from info to warning, so only warnings are now logged. And if I restart my server and load the page, I just get which requests have been done and no more SQL queries in the middle of it. Now, this is fine. I can see the page I created on the database. The issue is that there is no way to edit it and no way to create new pages. So the next thing we are going to add is the ability to actually edit pages. Okay, so to do this, I'm going to create an edit controller. And my controller is going to get the page ID and nothing more, actually, at the moment. And it's just going to return the page I need to edit. Well, I can actually work by page name. It makes more sense. I think that a real example actually works by page name. And what template I'm going to expose? Well, the tutorial suggests you to actually expose the same exact template. So we just copy it. We copy our page template to the edit.html template, so we don't need to start from scratch. So I'm going to go again in my templates directory. I'm going to copy my page to edit.html. And what I'm going to change? I'm going to add to the template a form to make possible to edit the page. So you have the form already written for you inside the tutorial, so I'm just going to copy it. And I'm going to put it like at the top, so you can put it wherever you want. Voila. The new form is going to accept a needed input, which are going to use just to pass back and forth the name of the page we are editing. is going to accept the data of the page. And just going to provide the submit button. And the example actually gives a name to the submit button, but I prefer to omit it, because if you don't provide a name, if you provide a name, the value of the submit button gets submitted with the form, which is something which is totally useless, and I don't want it to happen usually. So I just remove the name, so my submit button doesn't get in the middle. And where I'm going to submit what I edit? Well, first, let me finish my controller. I go back to my edit method, and now I know that it has to expose my project templates.edit. Okay. And if I go here and I try to edit my page, I now get a form to edit the page. But if I try to save it, I get a 404 because I didn't yet implement any method that saves my page. Where the form submits is declared by the form itself. If you look at the form template, if you look at the form declaration, you see that it has an action attribute. This is where your form gets submitted. So we are going to declare a method named save that can cache the data of my page and save and update it.
The database connection in TurboGames, yes? Does it open a connection every time, or does it have a mechanism that's
okay? It has a connection pool. Okay. So it, by default, if I'm not wrong, you have like 10 open connections in the pool, and I don't remember if 5 or 10 more of overflow. But that's not the case in, when you're using SQLite. When you're using SQLite, it switches to a null pool, so it opens and closes the file each time. But yes, for more complex database system, you have a connection pooling. So now, I'm going to declare my save method. My save method won't expose any template because it just gets values and then sets my users away. And it's going to get the page name because one of the inputs I provided in my form was actually the page name, which is hidden. So the user is not able to change the page name. But we get it back, so we can use it to look up for the page on the database. And then I get the actual data of the page, which is the text we need to replace into the existing page, which is called data, right? Yeah. I'm going to look up the page as usual. And then I'm going to update it. How do I update it? Well, the page is actually a plain object, so if I want to change the data, I just can do page.data equals data. And then I just send my user back to the page. Voila, and this is all I need. So now if I change my page content, here there is some more page content. And I'm going to save it, and here my page changed. I'm sent back to the page I just edited, and it gets updated with the new content. I can edit again and save it again. I get sent back to the page again. And what happens if I try to put here like some HTML? It happens that instead of being rendered, it gets escaped automatically, so you are safe on this. Users cannot put something that is going to break your HTML, because Genshi performs automatic escaping by default of every data you pass to the template. So you don't have to think about doing it yourself. Now, something it would be great is telling to the users that you actually edited the page successfully. And to do this, TurboGears provides an utility command, which is the flash, which is the same we saw here. These alerts we see are provided by the TurboGears flash. So I can use it myself. And I'm going just to write a flash that tells to the user that the page got successfully updated. And no more. So now when I edit my page and save it, I get that it got successfully updated. And if I reload the page, the flash is not there anymore because I didn't update anything in this case. So now I'm able to edit my index page, which is actually the only page I get. I created only that. But I probably want to be able to create more pages. So what I'm going to do? First of all, I'm going like to make so that my pages controller serves the index directory and index page whenever I don't provide a page, so that whenever a user asks for pages, it gets the index page by default. So I just provide it as the default argument for my pages controller. So whenever I go to pages, I go to the index. Then I'm going to adapt my template, my page template. Oh, it's already there. And like the change with the default argument is just to make so that whenever you go to the index page, you get the actual index page. And here I have the link to edit the page. And I can provide a link to also create pages. Why is it really? Okay. I'm just going to copy it. Let me see. I can do something smarter, actually. I can check it for page name. Okay. See, I'm editing my page controller. Now, instead of getting the page name from the model, I get it directly. Okay. So now in my controller, I do the same thing I had before. But instead of passing only the wiki page, I also pass the page name I got as the argument. Okay, you're going to see soon why. And everything should work like before. If I go here, I still see that I'm at the index. If I go like more, I should see that there are no more pages, and so on. And this is the next thing we are going to check. Instead of using one, which performs some kind of checks that make sure that I get one and only one result, I'm going to switch it from one to first. So I just get the first result available. And if there is no result, I'm going to get none. So my wiki page, when I'm looking for a page that doesn't exist, will be none. And my page name will be exactly the name I provided at the URL. So now I try again. And the next issue I have is that my none object, which is not a wiki page, doesn't have a page name, because somewhere inside my template it's probably referred the page name. I can see it here that at the line 17, there is a replacement of the title of the page. So I go back to my template and switch that replacement with, again, the plain page name. And last but not least, I remove the page data if there is no page. Okay, now if I run it and I don't have a page in place, it crashes due to the page data missing. So now I'm going to make the page data conditional. So instead of always trying to display the page data and crash if it is not there, I'm going to add the pyif statement, which is going to show this tag only when that pyif is true. Index it something you can easily read. So now this div is going to be available only if I have a page in place. And if I have a page in place, it's going to be replaced with the data of the page. So now I'm going to run my code again and go to more. What did I forget? Oh, yeah, the editing. And I make these two page name too. And I reload, and now finally I get an empty page. Okay. Now to create a new page, we are going to use the edit function. So whenever I go to the edit, I again get my no result error because it's going to use none. I'm going to switch it back to first like I did before. And I'm just going to add a check. If my page is there, I'm going to return it. Otherwise, I'm just going, like before, to make things available. And pay a wiki page. I'm going to edit my template. My edit template. And exactly the same actions I did for my page template, I'm going to replicate them. So make the page.page name replaced by the plain page name. And I'm going to do, like, shouldn't be here. I'm also going to remove the current page data. I actually have it inside the form. And here should be everything. Those are the changes that I already did in the page template. And the other thing I'm going to change is the text area content. Okay. Currently inside my text area, I get the data of the page I'm editing. And if I don't have a page, I want to get just an empty data instead of crashing. So again, I'm going to like do this, and I'm going to pass it from my controller. So instead of passing my whole model to the template, I'm just going to pass each data of the model to the template, so I can voila. Edit it, you see that if I open an existing page, I get the page text. If I open a new page, I now get an empty text, and I'm able to edit pages that don't exist yet. So now what I'm going to do is actually trying to create a page and save it, and of course see that again it's going to fail also my same method like it did before. Yeah.
Sorry, one question. On the bottom you have a debugger, right?
Yeah.
No.
It's not on WebSocket. It performs. No, it's not in polling neither. It just opens the debugger page at first crash. Then whenever you perform some kind of action, you submit an Ajax request to the debugger and read what you do.
Oh, okay.
It's no continuous transport in any way. Just when you perform something, you send an action and so on. And you can actually run code inside, like print hello.
Like
yeah, at the point you just stopped, and there is invalid syntax because I'm on Python 3. And I just get print, and you can actually get the information of where you are, like you can print the context, which is the current request. While on TurboGears 2.2, it was used a library which was called the WebError, which was written by Ben Bargert of Pylons. While on, maybe by Ian Beeking, I'm not sure, I don't remember. Well, anyway, it's not important. While in TurboGears 2.3, it's actually a library called Backlash, you see here, which is a fork of the Verzug debugger, ported to WebOb, and... Yeah, the Verzug debugger is the one used by Flask.
Exactly, and this is a port of it.
Yeah, it's a port to WebOb, because the Flask debugger uses Verzug, while this uses WebOb.
Okay.
And it's a standalone library, so you can actually enable it in any project you want, even on other frameworks and so on. Yeah, it's pretty well done. Most of the work is actually being made by Z. It's just plain Verzug debugger, just adapted in some places. So the TurboGears team didn't work much on this. We just used something that was already there and works really well. If you want a WebSocket debugger, there is one, which is called the WUDB, and it performs everything to WebSocket. Well, the feature which are available in the WebSocket debugger is that you can actually have an interactive interpreter while running the application, so you can stop it yourself, you can inject, so you can edit the application while it's running. You can do something like this also in the debugger, because you can open the shell, if I remember how to do it. Well, I don't remember actually, but there is a link to get to the shell, to an interactive shell inside the application stack from the browser, which is like underscore debug shell, if I'm not wrong. But
another question too, like TurboGears, how does it handle concurrency? Is it just like threaded model?
The default gearbox server daemon, it's actually not concurrent at all. It's implemented on Whiskey Reference, so it should be used only to work on your machine. But as it is space deploy compatible, you can switch it to whatever you want. Like in the development ini, here you tell which backend to use. And by default, it's Whiskey Reference, but you can, for example, say gevent, it's going to serve it on gevent. And do you have like support for Waitress, and it's going to serve it on Waitress and so on.
Which
so
which is the best
it depends on what you need to do. Yeah. I usually switch between Waitress and gevent. And on some websites we use mod whiskey. So you don't use any backend, you just rely on Apache itself to serve things.
Thank you.
Okay, now what I'm going to do is adapt my save controller so we can actually create a new page. So again, switch from one to first so we can actually get an empty result. I'm going to perform a check. If my page is none, so there is no page on the database, I'm just going to create a new page. And I'm also going to add it to my session, so it gets saved. And then, exactly like before, I'm going to set the data of the page. Well, maybe I want to set a page name. Okay, fine. So now my page gets created and gets added to the session. And what happens is that TurboGears is going to automatically save it through a transaction whenever I exit from my controller. So you should always think of controller as something which is wrapped in the database transaction. Whenever you enter a controller, a transaction is started. Whenever you exit it, a transaction is committed. Actually, it doesn't happen really like that because they are just registered in a unit of work which is flashed at the end and so on. But you can think somehow like that. So if my page has been successfully added to the database, the transaction is committed, otherwise it just rolled back. And now I'm going to see what happens. It should be already working, because I hope I didn't forget anything. And if I save it, I actually get your page has been updated. I go to the more page, and I see that this is a new page. So everything is working. I can edit it and like change it somehow and go back and edit my more page. I can even create new pages. I create a new page, edit it, and save it. So now I have the ability to create new pages and so on. The next thing I'm going to do is actually list on the sidebar on my wiki all the available pages so user can see them and go there. And to do this, I'm going to go back in my page controller, pages controller, and I'm going to get all the pages. And this will be a much simpler query, which just performs a model.page and has no filters. It just gets all the pages. And going to forward it to my template like before. And now I should already have a working job for that template. Yes, do. And on my sidebar, which is, where is it? Oh, here. Yeah, okay. And here I'm going to list all the pages. How I'm going to list them? Well, I'm just going to create a div for each of them to the py for statement, which is provided by Genshi. And here inside my div, I have any variable I declared in the for statement. Difficult to write with only one N. And I'm just going to print my other page dot page name. Okay, fine. Now I go back to my pages and here I see the list of all the pages which are available in my wiki, and maybe you also want to make them links so you can actually go to that page and back and so on. Well, I think we followed pretty much everything about our tutorial, and this is the last thing we can do on Python 3. from now on, we actually need to switch back to Python 2. And that makes us really sad. But we are going to see how to make widgets and so on, so we actually need to go back to Python 2, which has support from them. And I also actually going to get a new microphone so I can write again. No new microphone, but still going back to Python 2. Okay, some of the features which are available on Python 2 and that are not on Python 3. Internationalization support, actually not the support itself, but the utilities. So like on Python 3, you can translate your text, but you won't have the command to collect all the strings that you need to translate and so on. Widgets, on Python 3, we don't have support for widgets yet. And MongoDB support is not available on Python 3, and the TurboGears admin is not available because it depends on widgets. So, the first thing I'm going to introduce you are the forms, which are actually just widgets. Why? Because currently we wrote the form by hand, and you can see it if you go to your edit page. Should be this one. And this is my form. I wrote it by hand. It's been a tedious task. I can put a lot of errors, and I need to like check what the user wrote. He might have sent like an empty page name, tried to bypassing my checks. Or if there is no data, I need like to send some feedback to the users telling him, hey, you must provide some data for the page and so on. And this is something which is really, really long to do by hand for forms in HTML. So TurboGears provides the Tosca Widgets library, which is a good way to write forms automatically and have validation and so on. So we don't have to care about rendering the form, validating the input, and sending back errors to the user in case something went wrong. So, changing mic. Prova. Okay, it's working. Okay, let's see how widgets and forms support. First, I'm going to switch back to Python 2. So I'm going to switch back to my Python 2 environment. The first thing I'm going to do is disable my P3 environment and enable my Py2 environment. And now I'm actually on Python 2. Next, I'm going to edit my project setup.py file, adding the Tosca widget dependency, because as I quick started with the --skip Tosca widget option, I don't have it between my dependencies, so you can add it by hand. It's called just tw2.forms. And now I need to edit my application configuration to turn on Tosca widgets, which is available inside my proj config. And here you have an app.gfg file, which is where your application config is actually set up for you. You remember that when we started with a single file, we created an app.config object and so on. And here is where the app.config object is created for full stack applications. So you see that here it gets created, empty renders output, and there you have a lot of options. And one of those is to enable Tosca widgets too. So I'm just going to enable it. And this should be as far as it need to go to have Tosca widgets working. So I'm going to install my application on the Python 2 environment. I need to run this again because before I installed it on a Python 3 environment, so the dependencies and the application itself are not available on my Python 2 environment. You see that the application is bringing in also TurboGears, but actually it depends on TurboGears and not on the development tools, so I'm not going to have the gearbox command and so on. So you probably also want to perform pip install to TG dev tools again. Okay, now we have everything set up in my Python 2 environment. And like before, I can just start my application. So I'm going to start it again. And everything works exactly like before, because I wrote code which is perfectly compatible on both Python 2 and Python 3 works the same and there are no problems. So I can just switch from one to the other without any issue. And everything continues to work. Now I'm just going to wait a bunch of seconds to make sure you have a working installation also on Python 2. Everyone has been able to make it work on Python 2. Okay, so I'm going forward and going to show you how to actually declare widgets. And this is a simple form widget, which is the same form we declared by HTML, just declared in Python. So we have our page name, which is a hidden field. We have our data field, which is a text area. And here we have where the form is going to be saved. I'm going to copy this. Oops. And I'm going to go back to my edit page. And now I'm going to remove my actual form. I'm going to replace it. With what I'm going to replace it? Well, with the Python declared form, which for simplicity I'm going to put it inside my root.py file. Wow. Yeah. Well, you can do it. Actually, the most simple way is declaring the class form inside the controller itself, because the form is just a class. So, for example, you can do like, I don't know, here inside my controller, I can have my if some condition. I can take my page form dot more field equals to tweb dot text area, and I added a more field. So you can edit like any other object in Python. This is the fastest and simple solution to edit the form on the fly. Now, the form is also declared with validators. You can see the validator parameter. These are going to be used to check the data that the user wrote. So whenever you submit the form, every data submitted is checked through the validators of the form. In this case, we have a pretty simple validator that just requires the data to be there and nothing more. Okay. So we are going to see validators soon. In the meantime, I'm just going to show the form in my page. And to do this, I'm going to provide the form to the template. So I'm just going to pass the form variable to my template. And inside the template, actually it was the wrong place, because I need to pass it to the edit page. Now, what I need to do is to show it. So I'm going to go back to my page. And here, now that I have my form, I can run form.display. And here my form gets displayed inside the page. So if I reload my page back and go to the edit page, oh, there is a syntax error. That happens when you try to copy things from PDF files. What was this intercept? On data? Ah, yeah. Here. Okay, form undefined. Why? Because I named it page, of course. Let me form. And voila. Now, my page form is in place. But it's currently empty, because I'm not giving any data to the form. Okay, so I can pre-fill my form. I'm going to do it passing a value to the form. A value is just a dictionary of the values for the form itself. I'm going to pass my current data as the value for the form. So I get here now my working form. And you see that we declare the validators, but if I try to write an empty string, even though we actually set the validator for the data field, so we should not be able to submit an empty data field, if I try to do that, I can actually do that. Okay, this is because we are not actually validating the form currently. We just declare the validators, but we didn't use them. And To validate the phone, we are going to use a feature of TurboGears, which is validation, which works with any, with a lot of different validation libraries, Form Encode, Tosca Widget, Tosca Widget 2, and so on. And the form itself is a valid validator for TurboGears. So I'm going, you see that I imported from the TG namespace the validate command. I'm going to add to my save controller the validation for the form. So I just tell to the save controller that it has to validate for page form any data that it gets. Okay? So whenever my save controller receives some data, it validates it against the form. And if I don't pass the validation, what I'm going to do is go back to the edit page. So I'm going to tell to the validator that the error handler is the edit page itself. So this is enough to validate against the form, and if I don't pass validation, go back to the edit page. And not only this is enough to provide validation, okay. Well, the edit page is going to receive all the attributes that were submitted to the form, so I just put a catch-all argument. And this is not only enough to validate the form, but this is also enough to get an error message for the user. So here, the widgets library is going to tell to the user for me that he needed to insert something inside the data. So if I submitted an empty data, I get near the form which didn't pass validation, which was the error. So I'm going to fill it with some value, save it again, and everything should work. Right. Okay. Now you have seen how to create forms, how to validate them, and how to manage errors in case of failed validation. The next thing we are going to do is actually see how we can... What happened? Okay. We are going to see how to actually translate our messages, because we provide a success alert to the user. Let me just remove the URL call, it's not required at all. Oh, I forgot actually one thing to the form, which is passing the page name, otherwise I'm not going to edit any page. I'm just creating new pages. I save it and now it works as expected. It edited the page. Yeah, it's still provided by, because escaping is provided by the template engine, not by the form library itself. So now I'm going to try to translate my message, which I'm going to do by using the Babel toolkit. And translation, as I told you, is available on both Python 3 and Python 2, but is not available the methods to collect languages, generate translation files, and so on. They are only available on Python 2 currently. And the first thing I need to do to perform translation is actually install the Babel toolkit inside my PyTorch environment. And TurboGears has built-in support for Babel. So what does this mean? It means that whatever you wrap into a getText call from TurboGears, you see that here we have some utilities for internationalization and translation. which are the lazy UGET text and UGET text calls. And if I wrap some text in the underscore call, like my success message, this will be automatically collected and translated. And now to perform the actual collection, there are a lot of comments. If you want to follow the whole tutorial, this is the link. We are going just to make a simple example creating the Italian translation for my message. So the first command I need to run is python setup.py extract messages. Not in this directory. Okay, and this is going to scan my whole project, all my templates, all my controllers and so on, and look for phrases that need to be translated. From this scan is written a template, which is like a skeleton for language support. And from this template, I can actually create support for a language, which in this case is going to be Italian. So I'm just going to create a new catalog for the Italian language. I run this, and it gets created a PO file inside my distribution. I can edit the PO file in whatever tool I like PO edit. And you see that here I have all the text which is available inside my application. If it is something which is inside the controller, you need to wrap it into a getText call. If it is something which is available inside the Genshi template, it gets automatically detected. So you see here that I have every paragraph or tag that contains text inside my template gets automatically translated. So I'm just going to add a translation for my page updated message with the Italian translation. I'm going to save it back. Okay. And now what I'm going to do, I'm going to compile my catalog so TurboGears can start using it. Voila. Now I have a working translation for Italian. It tells me that only one of 130 messages got translated. I don't care much, just wanted to show you the page error message. Now what happens? It happens that TurboGears automatically detects the user language. It provides for me the correct message in the required language. So if I try to edit things from here, which is an English environment, and save it, I get the page updated alert in English. If I try to do the same thing from my Firefox, which is set up in Italian, and I go to like page 8080, and like I go to pages, index, and I edit my page, and I save it, I get pagina aggiornata in Italian. Because TurboGears detected that my browser is in Italian, and it's going to serve all the translation for the Italian language automatically. So you can see that it's pretty simple and doesn't require a particular effort to have a multi-language application. And by default, the language is detected from the browser, but you can actually enforce it in many ways, like you can set the default language, you can load it from the session, there are a bunch of utilities to set the language like in the preferences of the user or whatever you might need to do. But the default behavior is just to load it from the browser, which is the one that makes sense more usually. No, it's up to you. If you have something on the database, you need to perform the getText calls, and it works like any string you have in the controller. The issue is that as they are in the database, they cannot be automatically collected by TurboGears. So you have to perform some kind of manual collection, or you need to make available a translation to an interface on the website itself, and so on. Well, The translation is up to you, but it's not that it's actually up to you. You just have to wrap into a get text call what you want to translate, like we did for the flash. Okay, instead of like, let me quit Firefox for a second. Let me go back to my controller. Here, you see that I'm translating a message, but I can also like translate something I loaded from the database, which doesn't make a lot of sense in this case, but I can do that if I want, and it will work perfectly. But Turbo Gears, in my PO file, I won't see this because I don't know what it is page name at before actually running the application. So you have to collect the strings you want to translate by yourself. The, you can see, yeah, in the POT actually, which is the template. You can see that it's not really complex because POT files are actually like plain text files with every single string. So you can add one and be happy with that. Or you can even do more complex things like setting up a get text translator, because behind the get text calls it actually uses a translator, and you can declare a custom translator that looks up for the translation on the database itself, so you don't have to have them on a PO file and so on. You can make any solution you prefer. Actually, there is nothing enforced by Turbo Gears itself. So next thing we are going to see is how to use the Turbo Gears admin. And we have seen how to edit pages and create pages, but there are a lot of more features we are missing, like searching for pages, deleting pages, and so on. And this is will be a lot of code. And there is something which can create the code for us, which is the Turbo Gears admin. And I don't want to write it myself. I want someone else to write it for me. And that's the reason why the admin is there, okay? As we started with the skip Tosca widget option, we need again to install it manually, but it's not complex, it's just pip install tgx admin. And it will fetch dependencies and so on. Fine. Now I can mount inside my controller. The Turbo Gears admin is actually nothing magical. It's just a controller you can mount inside your application and tell him which models have to be editable by the controller. So I can edit my root. And I just add here, I create a Turbo Gears controller. I import the Turbo Gears admin. Voila, which is actually just a plain Turbo Gears controller and an admin configuration. The TG admin config is the default one, so you don't need to write one yourself. And you can just mount it like any other subcontroller. So I can go inside my root controller, and I'm going to remove the doc string so I have some free space. And here I'm going to add my admin. Sorry. Voila. And what I'm doing here is actually create the Turbo Gears controller, which is going to work on every model of my application. If you just pass the model module, you just get all the models of your application edited by the admin. And on this database, because Turbo Gears actually supports multiple database backends, so you can pass, like, have an admin, especially when you perform vertical sharding, you can have like vertical partitioning, you can have like users on a database and groups on another, maybe groups not, makes sense to have them together, but users on a database and like messages on another database, and you want one admin, the one in charge of editing users to work on a database, and you want the admin in charge of editing messages work on another database, so you can explicitly pass the session the admin has work on. And you can set a configuration type. I'm just going to provide the default one, which TurboGears provides for me. And now, if everything worked, I can go back to my application, which is running here. And my admin button now works. I have a list of all the models available in my database. I can go inside the section and have a table that lists them. I can like search for them by, I don't know, page name, and I get filtered, or I can like or sort them by some kind of data, or you can of course delete them. Here I have an empty page. I'm going to remove it because I don't need it, and if I need to edit it, I'm just going to edit it. And you see that by default, it makes possible to edit any attribute that your model has. So I can rename the page, and I can also make some content. I'm going to save it, and you see that it got updated. Yeah. And one of the issues is that the admin decided the validators from the model. So in this case, if I try to set an empty data, I'm able to do it because for the form I declared, I explicitly set a validator, while for the model, I didn't say anything on the fact that it cannot be empty. If you want to make like your model your field required, you can just go back to your model, edit your page, and here inside the data I can set nullable false, which makes impossible to have an empty data on the database, and will tell also to the admin that it's automatically prevent people from setting empty values because my model cannot be nullable. And it will, for example, also detect collisions like there is already a field like this on the database and so on. It does a lot for you, so you can actually, it went far away by itself. It can actually be a powerful tool for rapid prototyping. And it's based on the TGX CRUD extension, which makes it super easy to create CRUD interfaces, REST API, and so on. Whatever you need to do, you just put that in. It's easy for real, like, let me show you. If instead of using the admin, I want, for example, to do things myself, and suppose that instead of using the admin, which also permits to edit pages, edit users, and so on, I just want to provide a controller to edit pages. So I can import from TGX CRUD the easy CRUD REST controller. And now I just declare a CRUD REST controller for pages. And just tell that the model that it has to edit is the page itself. And just make mount it somewhere. Voila. How did I name it? With the underscore. And now if I go to my pages admin, I have a fully working controller which also supports REST. Like if I say .json, I get the result as a JSON output with pagination and so on. So it automatically also create for you a REST API. Now, if you want to have more information on TurboGears admin, there is a pretty good tutorial, which is the Wikia tutorial, which is still available at the same place as every other documentation for TurboGears. And it implements the wiki in 20 minutes, but instead of doing it writing things yourself, it just tells you how to customize the admin. So it's a good example of how to make custom things inside the admin, make custom validation, change file types, field types, and so on. One thing I can suggest you about the admin is that you don't want to push it too far. If you have a too complex admin, it gets messy to maintain, to customize, and so on. If you have more than like 10 options inside your admin, you probably want to rewrite things from scratch by yourself. Because while you can customize the admin a lot, you can even change it, but its behavior, you can change practically anything. The admin is a plain TurboGears controller, so you can subclass it and replace everything you want. But it gets more messy than writing things from scratch if you go over a certain amount of time. And especially Django users probably have bad experience with this because they often start with the Django admin and they end up monkey patching it everywhere. Yeah. So don't try to do that. Your life will be easier.
Django admin 2 now. There's another one.
Perfect. Yeah, it's an option, it's not in by default, but you can enable it if you want. There is a cross-site forgery middleware you can enable and you have like cross-site checks. Okay, and about the REST API, which is automatically generated for you, it's actually pretty powerful. There are a lot of options. Like by default it's fully REST compliant, so you get like correct error codes, like bad request if you don't pass validation. You have conditional put support with if unmodified scene support, if your model has an update at that field. You get like you can send the data as a JSON fields inside the body of the request, or you can send them to parameters. Actually, you can do a lot of things, has a lot of options, and it will require an entire training session all by itself just to write simple REST APIs. I'm actually going to have a talk tomorrow on writing a REST API, which is going to show some parts of the TGX crude automatic API generation, so you might want to join if you want to have more information. And the next thing I want to show you is that actually TurboGears, one of the core features it has, is the TGX pluggable, which permits to have pluggable applications in TurboGears. If you need to do something like a blog, or you need to have a Facebook authentication, or you need to have a user's registration, or a lot of things, you might want to do profiles for your users and calendar with the events, or whatever you might need to do. You might want to check the Cogbin, which is available on the TurboGears website, and is a repository of official extensions, which are really common in the TurboGears community, used, has been tested, and so they are publicly available on the Cogbin. If I go to the TurboGears website, and I go to the Cogbin page, you can see that here you have a list of what you have. Like, there is a CMS, which is actually not compatible with TurboGears 2.3. We have e-commerce, we have a switchboard, which is a pretty cool extension to like enable or disable conditionally features to your user for A/B testing and so on. You have support for events and calendars, you have support for Facebook authentication, photo galleries, registration, blogs, comments attached to anything, polls for profiles, videos from YouTube, And those are the so-called pluggable applications. And there are like extensions which are more like lower level. They're not ready-made application, but features you can use inside your own application, like asynchronous forms that get submitted by Ajax, asynchronous jobs, or like limiting the version your browser can get to avoid people having Internet Explorer 6 go to your website and see everything broken, support for CoffeeScript, support for a bunch of utilities. You want to know this module because it makes your life a lot easier. Like support for people that want to use it, support for Django forms in Turbo Gears, for less minification, mobile version of a website, and support for routes if you have to perform complex routing, support for SCSS and SAS if you want to use them, tagging and a lot of things. The more important extension you want to know that it exists and you want to use is actually the debug bar. The debug bar can make your life a lot easier. You always want to have it enabled inside the project because it tells you a lot of things, tells you about errors, performances, and so on. So I'm just going to show you how to enable the debug bar in our wiki project so that you can see what it does for us. Okay, the first thing I need to do is install the support for pluggable applications, because the debug bar is actually a pluggable application itself. And then I need to install the debug bar. And now inside my environment, I have support for the debug bar. To enable it, I just need to plug it inside my application configuration. So it's not really hard. I can go inside my usual application configuration, and at the end, I'm just going to import the pluggable plug function, and I'm going to plug my debug bar inside my application configuration. Here we are. This is all I need to do to enable the debug bar. And if I go back to my project, you can see up at the end of the project that you have now the debug bar. And what it does for us? Well, the debug bar does a lot of things for you, like it tells you information of performance of your website, like how much time it took to render your page, the time spent on controller, the total time you spent to serve the page, every template you rendered inside your controller, being it the page template or any partial you rendered from the page itself. And it performs profiling. You can see what your controller called. Actually, my controller is empty and didn't call anything. And you can get the every data that got sent to your request. Like here I have some cookies. Here I have my whiskey headers. I have the request object, the current user identity, and so on. And here the most important part is a SQL Alchemy inspection. So like if I go to my pages controller, like before, and I open the SQL Alchemy inspection, I can see every single query that the controller did. Okay? And you can see how much time it took by each single query, and you can see like the results returned by the query. In this case, it returned 3 because this was a count query. I like open this version and get some results. You can see that it returned this data. I can also like explain the query, which is going to tell me like if it used any index or so on. And in this case, it didn't use any index because it was just a select all. And then I can see which controllers are currently mounted in my application and which URLs are served. Like I have my pages admin controller that I created myself. Like I have the debug bar itself is a controller. And like I have my secure controller which exposes the index and somewhere. You can have logging. If you don't want to look at your shell, you can actually look here and get logging information. And you have a pretty cool feature which is the inventing mode. You want to enable this if you are experimenting with your website, because once it's enabled, you have actually to enable it permanently. So I'm just going to do it here. Voila. Okay, inventing mode is now enabled. And I go back to my index page. And now, for example, I want to change the text on my paragraph. So I go to my editor. I open my favorite editor and edit my template like this paragraph, the one on design architecture. And instead of saying design URL architecture, I'm going to say like design your beautiful application and just save and go back to my website and change on real time. So you can experiment changing your pages and it gets automatically updated on the browser in real time. So it's pretty cool when working like in the design phase where you have to try like different things. You can change the CSS, you can change anything. Like I want to make everything red, I can go here. I go like here and add a style statement. And I make every H1 red. I close my style and go back to my website and it became red. There is nothing to make red actually. It's like H3. Make all my H3 red and go back to my website and it should have become red. Why it didn't? Let me inspect it. Oh, because it's overwritten. So I found an issue in my CSS. I go back, I make it like important. I go back to my web page and now I see that it finally became red. So it permits you to edit on the fly the web page without having to reload the page and so on. It gets automatically updated inside the browser whenever you change something. I go back and save it again and everything is black again. So it's a pretty cool feature that makes possible to experiment on the fly with your web page. And also, for example, if you broke your application, like I forget to close the style, the bug bar gets red and tells you it's currently broken and it doesn't get you the error. If you want to see the error, you just reload the page and you see the error. Or like I have a broken page, I see it's broken, now I fix my error and the bug bar goes back to black. So it tells me that my error got fixed. And for example, if I disable the web server, it tells me that it's currently in warning state, it's impossible to get to the web server. It's yellow. If I start the web server again, it goes back to black and reloads the page. So it's a pretty cool feature that makes really easier for developer to experiment and try things on the fly and so on. I'm just going to disable it again for now. And now we have seen the debugger in action. And we are going to see a last thing, support for MongoDB. MongoDB, for people that don't know it, is a pretty cool database. It's far from this classic SQL database. It's faster, easier to scale. And actually, the core part is that it's really, really, really super easy to scale. It performs automatic sharding and replication and so on. So when you need to write an application that has to support thousands and thousands and thousands and millions of users, you want to use MongoDB because you just start another node and things go back fast as before. So website goes slow again, you just start another node and it automatically distributed the content and so on. So it's a pretty simple solution for that. And the object document mapper that is used by TurboGear is called Ming. Ming was actually the evil emperor of Mongo from Flash Gordon, so that's the reason why it's called Ming. And to enable MongoDB support, it's as simple as passing the --- Ming command to your application. Like, I go back and now I create a MongoDB project. I quick start. Start Mongo proj, it gets created, And I need, of course, to run MongoD, otherwise it won't work. And if I run like before my setup app, it's going to create things and so on. Well, I forgot to install the project. You see that it's now installing Ming instead of SQL Alchemy and PyMongo. And I run the setup app, and everything is created on my MongoDB. I run my website like before, and everything looks just the same. I can log in, I have my manager, I have my admin, I can edit users. I see that it's on MongoDB just because my ID is now a hash instead of a number. But everything works exactly like before. You don't have to care that you are using MongoDB or something else. Everything works. The admin works. You can create new users. You can edit things. You just switch from a database to another one. And TurboGears covers that for you. Of course, if you need to write manually queries and so on, you need to know how Ming works, because otherwise you cannot do that. But Ming is pretty simple for people that know SQL Alchemy, because it's really similar. The syntax is nearly the same. It has like the concept of the session, the concept of the model. You perform a query on the model to the session and ask for the first one, all, and so on. It returns you the cursor. It just really like SQL Alchemy, just the way you set the query is a little different, because MongoDB is different. And you still have support in the bug bar for MongoDB. If your controller is doing MongoDB queries, you can see them. Like, I can enable my debug bar and show you. Like, I go in the config and go in apt-chfg and go at the end and plug my debug bar again. And I just start my project again. The bug bar is plugged, and you see the SQL Alchemy entry got replaced by the Ming entry. And if I go here, like somewhere that does some queries, and I open my debug bar, I see all the queries that got executed on MongoDB, which is a user.find command with limit of 7, group.find for the group name in empty list because it's looking for no groups, and group.find in the managers, and I ask for results and so on, and it tells me back whatever I want to return. It works exactly like the SQL Alchemy support, it's just on MongoDB. And if you know how the unit of work pattern works, which is the way SQL Alchemy works, whenever you perform any kind of change or create a new object, you are not actually creating it on the database. You are registering inside the unit of work that you want to perform that action. And only when you flush the unit of work at the end of your controller, it gets performed for real. And Ming works the same way. There's a unit of work. You register there whatever operation you want to do on Mongo. And at the end of controller, it gets flushed. The only difference is that as MongoDB has no transactions, there is no transaction manager, so no rollback. If you failed flushing your changes at the middle, you actually perform half of the changes. So you want to pay attention on that. And you may want to use atomic operation, as MongoDB has atomic operation concepts like find and modify in only one statement and so on. And as we have seen, the debug bar works, and there's like cool syntax highlighting for JavaScript, because in MongoDB you can actually tell to the database to execute JavaScript on the database. And if your query contains JavaScript like for MapReduce and so on, it gets highlighted. And support for the admin, TJX root, and so on. And this is actually all I wanted to show you. So we actually ended a little earlier. If you have any question, feel free to ask. I'm here for that. So. Yeah.
I don't understand if you have two instances, or you can
Okay. When you are performing vertical scaling on the admin, you are asking me, well, how to manage that. Well, there are two ways. The first way, you can actually set up multiple admins, like pages admin and the users admin, and they have two different database sessions. You pass two different databases. Each database session is bound to an engine, and each engine is connected to a database server. And this is the most simple way. But if you want, you can have only one admin, and inside the model itself, you can declare which session is related to that model. SQL Alchemy Declarative permits to do that. So each time you use that model, you use that database. Actually, TurboGears has also built-in support for scaling, sharding, and master slave replication. So instead of declaring things yourself, you can just tell to TurboGears which model maps to which database or which are the master and the slaves. And whenever it is going to perform a read, it's going to automatically to perform it on a slave. And whenever it's going to perform an update or so on, it's going to automatically perform it on the master, and it does that a framework for you. So you have actually multiple ways to do that. It depends on what you need to do and how much control you want to have. The default solution works pretty well for a simple application. Might not work if you are trying to do something really complex or kind of strange distribution of your data and so on. And it supports only one master, so it's no support for multi-master replication and things like that. Okay, if there are no other questions, I think we can finish here. Fine.
Sorry,
yeah?
I have a question. One second.
Yeah.
I found it really interesting, but so I come from a Django background, for example,
yeah?
Yes? And for example, there are many things which are common to Django, many things which are less common to Django. So for example, the idea of Django is basically you create a project and that project is meant, what I mean is that with Django, there's one way of creating a project, right?
Yeah.
From what I understood there are like multiple ways and it's far less sort of declarative in like what you should have as a default package.
Yeah.
Yes. Said this. What do you think about the standard configuration that comes with TurboGears? Is it good, or would you recommend something else on top
no,
of it?
No, the standard one is pretty good. It's
okay.
Great for medium big projects.
Okay.
It's already like divided and set up in split modules and so on. I just tend to use the minimal modern. My own custom declaration if I have to do something really small, like when I'm doing features for my Raspberry Pi, I'm not going to create a whole project, just a single file and put there things. Or if I have to create a really simple web service, I don't set up a whole project, just create a bunch of files. TurboGears is more like the flexibility which is provided by like Flask or Pyramid, which don't enforce a specific way how to set up your project. You can do that how you want.
Okay.
But TurboGears is more like the default way, the suggested way is through the quick start. But if you don't want to use it, you are free to do that if you know what you are doing.
Because for example, you know, with Django, the first thing everyone puts in their project is like self-migrations and stuff like this, things that are basically like suggested package which are in every Django project. So
the same is done for TurboGears. If you use the quick start, you automatically get Alembic for migrations and so on. But if you want to avoid using them, you can do that by yourself and no one is going to complain. You just have a project which will look strange to other TurboGears developers.
All right, thank you.